Good morning.
Good morning.
I have really been looking forward to sharing with you this morning. I've been praying for you in a generic kind of way, not knowing who would be here this morning, but praying that God would prepare your heart for a blessing and that he would use me to be able to stir your heart and your spirit and to move you closer to being a closer relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. We have just finished a major worldwide event. The streets of the cities all around the world were dancing with people in the street, celebrating or bemoaning the losses of their favorite soccer team, football in every other part of the world. Did you know Spain won, or didn't you care? Well, if soccer's not your favorite sport, something probably is, because we all have champions. We all have heroes. We all have role models that we look up to and we struggle to emulate. It says something about who we are by the champions that we look up to. A little bit about my age. Okay. When I was growing up, Muhammad Ali was the greatest. And I even looked up to him when he slowly became something less than the greatest, but he was something special. He was a talented, dynamic, sparkling personality. And I didn't agree with everything he did or said, but he was sure wonderful when it got in the ring. Maybe that wasn't the best hero to have, and I certainly wouldn't encourage anybody to look up to Mike Tyson, who followed him, but there have been a lot of my heroes. I remember back before they even had televised events that you could watch, I was listening to Richard Petty win NASCAR races when I lived down in Missouri, and it just seemed like nobody could touch him. He was the king. He was cool. And then when I moved back to Indiana, and of course you always were watching the, well, I'm sorry. If you remember anything about Indiana, it was always blacked out. The Indy 500 was never shown on television because nobody in Indiana was allowed to see it because they wanted you to travel to Indianapolis and watch it. So every day they'd come on there with it, and I'd have to listen to it on the radio. And I'd be in my grandfather's shop listening to A.J. Foyt, Mario Andretti, just roaring around the track. We thought nobody would ever beat these guys. And Johnny Rutherford was just a young upstart. Didn't think he'd amount to anything. Ladies and gentlemen, those are very, very small contests. And they are very, very small victors. Because next year, somebody else is going to win the Indy 500. And you'll say, Castellanos who? Because, that was last year's winner. There are some events that are so big that they stand out. They're in the record book. They're forever. I want to tell you about one of those this morning. Because when we look at the kind of contest that was happening in Jesus' day, there was a discussion going on. There was a debate being raged in all the homes and all the neighborhoods about who was the greatest, who was the highest. I want to read for you a section out of the Gospel of John. It's John, the 5th chapter, starting with verses 31 and following. Jesus, in the Gospel of John, has several what we call discourses, where he has a logical, rational presentation that goes through step 1, step 2, step 3, step 4. And in these presentations, he keeps moving from his weakest argument all the way up through the next step stronger message. And then finally, at the end, he concludes with his most powerful argument. And it's very logical. It was the way they taught back in Jesus' day. It was a rabbinical tradition. And I want to just read for you, if I may, the story of Jesus telling about the testimonies about himself. This is John, the 5th chapter, verses 31 and following. "If I testify about myself," Jesus said, "my testimony is not valid. There is another who testifies in my favor, and I know that his testimony about me is valid. You have sent to John," that's John the Baptist, "and he has testified to the truth. Not that I accept human testimony, but I mention it so that you might be saved. John was a lamp that burned and gave light, and you chose for a time to enjoy his light. I have a testimony weightier than that of John. For the very work that the Father has given me to finish, and which I am doing, testifies that the Father has sent me, and the Father who sent me has himself testified concerning me. You have never heard his voice nor seen his form, nor does his word dwell in you, for you do not believe in the one he sent. You diligently study the scriptures because you think that by them you'll possess eternal life. And these scriptures are the same ones that testify about me, yet you refuse to come to me to have life. But do not think that I will accuse you before my Father. Your accuser is Moses, on whom your hopes are set. If you believed Moses, you would have believed me, for he wrote about me. But since you do not believe what he wrote, how are you going to believe what I say?" You see, in those years, Moses had become such a huge figure in their history. He had become such an enormous man of importance that they believed that if they just followed Moses' teachings, if they just held on to Moses' law, if they would just do what Moses said for them to do and avoid the things that Moses said not to do, they would have life. That's what Moses told them in his closing sermon, in his closing message to them. He said, "Hold on to my words, because these are the words of life. You avoid them, you're going to die. It won't be pretty. If you want to live, just simply obey my words." And so Moses was the linchpin. He was the key to everything. If you take steps back in history, just take a quick look in your mind. Before Moses walked them out of Egypt, did they have any scripture that they could go to for reference of what God wanted for them to do? No, no scripture, no written text. They had the stories of the patriarchs, Abraham, Jacob, Isaac. But they didn't have any scripture. Did they have a law? No, they didn't have any law. They were just more or less a group of people that had a genetic marker that was the same. They grew up in the same family. They came out of the same general cultural circle, but they didn't have any worship form. They didn't have any laws. They didn't have any administration. There was no place they could go for worship. There was no common place that would tie them together in one unified community. Each family was their own individual unit, and they didn't really have much that they could do as a community of the people. They didn't have any priesthood. They didn't have any worship services. They didn't even have any structured methods for going to an altar and asking for God's forgiveness. They had nothing. They had no government. They had no hierarchy of people that you could go to help settle disputes. They had nothing culturally they could hold on to. They were not a people. When they were standing at the edge of the Red Sea, they were a mob, not a nation. When they stood on the banks of the Jordan River 40 years later, they were an army. They were a disciplined group of people who took orders and knew how to obey them faithfully. They were a nation. The only person you can go to, the only leader they had during that time was Moses. Everything they brought across the river was Moses doing. He was huge. He was huge. But they didn't take Moses across the river. Why? Because God said you can't go. God said you can't go. Well, when Jesus finally came to start his ministry, there was a great discussion. There was a huge debate as to just what it all meant to see Jesus preaching and teaching. And the longer he preached and the more things that he did, the more heated the discussion got. If I would be a color commentator, all right? I'm doing the pre-game show of this little dialogue here, the big play that's going to be coming up, the Super Bowl pre-game warm-up show. I'd say, ladies and gentlemen, we have one of the most interesting contests ever devised for man to view. Because these two candidates are lined up beautifully in comparison to each other. They both were born under the curse of a sentence of death. Moses, for his day, was under the sentence of death, where all the male children and all of the Israelite people were to be put to death at birth. But he was sneaked out and smuggled out and hidden away in a basket of reeds. And his life was spared. And Jesus, on the other hand, was given the death sentence by Herod the Great, sending in the troops into Bethlehem, kill all the male children under 2 years of age. They both were rescued by being in Egypt under the protection of a foreign king. They were both sort of under a death sentence their whole lives. Moses killed an Egyptian and was sent into the wilderness to spend 40 years as a shepherd in the wilderness, thinking that was as good as, or even worse than death. And Jesus had to keep a low profile even when he came back from Egypt, because Herod the Great's orders didn't go away. It was clear that he had been born in Bethlehem and had missed that little adventure where all the children were killed in Bethlehem. They might have come in after him again, because it was Herod's family who was still on the throne. So they hid out in a little place on the top of the hill overlooking the valley of Megiddo called Nazareth. And they just hung out there, sort of under the radar. Both of these great men were lawgivers. Moses, on the one hand, went up on Mount Sinai and brought back the Ten Commandments, written in tablets of stone by the very hand of God. But Jesus, we're told in Matthew, the fifth chapter, sixth chapter, seventh chapter, the Sermon on the Mount, he starts with a pattern that says, "You have heard it said in days of old, thou shalt not kill. But I say to you, don't even let your anger fester inside of you. Don't look at your brother or sister in contempt with a sense of bitterness or resentment." Well, wait a minute. Whoa. Hold the phone. That's Moses' law that you're saying, thou shalt not kill. And you're telling us that you're giving us an improved version of that law? Not while we're in charge. Moses is the man. You can't come in here and give a different law. You've heard it said, don't commit adultery. I say, don't even look with a lustful attitude. Nobody can live with that. You can't come in and make that claim. How dare you do that? You're not Moses. He's the one we're depending on. They were both lawgivers. And it caused tension when the people who were in charge of passing on Moses' traditions heard Jesus giving a new law. These two men were kings without thrones. They were kings without a physical place to sit in judgment on the people. Moses was never made the king. He did the work of the king. He had every one of the things a king would have. He had all of the authority. He had all of the power. He had all the respect of a king. But he had no throne. He was not considered the king. Jesus did the work of the king. He called people to follow him. He was a kingdom maker, and he called people to be a part of his kingdom. When he sent the disciples out two by two, he said, "The kingdom of heaven is at hand. Call people to join us." They were priests without temples. God gave Moses the command to build the tabernacle. It was with the idea that the tabernacle was going to change the relationship between God and man in a permanent, fundamental way. God tended to be worshipped in a single location. If you look at the history, you go back through it, somebody's going to build a temple, somebody's going to build a monument, and then they're going to worship God at that place. God said, no. He said to Moses, "We're going to build a tent, and we're going to place it in the center of our community. We're going to center it right in the middle of your hometown. And that's where I'm going to live. And every time we move, every time we pack up and change locations, I'm going to reset up my place to live in the middle of your community." Now, as they came across to the Jordan River and they started to set this up as a nation, David started to set up the thing of being that the kingdom was going to be in Jerusalem, headquartered there. They were going to have a palace there. And finally, Solomon built a temple there. But the point was, it began to become less and less a place where God lived in the midst of his people, and more going back to a single location where they could worship together. Jesus was something similar. He said, "God is where I am. I'm doing what he wants me to do." He shows that he is here and present with every miracle that he does in my ministry. God lives where I am. His power resides here. Much in the same way that God did when Moses was there. But they were priests before the people that didn't actually have a temple to worship in. So in many ways, these men were lined up perfectly alongside of each other. If you line their ministries up, you go, "Wow, I didn't realize there was such a parallel." But then, when you start comparing on an event-by-event basis, you'll find that Jesus surpasses Moses on every point. And here's where the problem came with the Jewish leaders and the resentment toward Jesus. The people were thirsty. They were facing certain death if they didn't get something to drink. They were in desperate condition. They were almost in panic. What were they going to do? They were in arid land and there was no water anywhere around. So God told Moses to do the impossible. Completely impossible event. Walk up to a solid block of rock, stone, and touch it with your rod, and it'll shoot forth water like it's been stored up like a sponge instead of a granite rock. And it'll pour out enough water that the whole people can be refreshed and their lives can be spared. So Moses did that. He walked over, he touched the rock, and today you can walk to the place where that happened, and you can see that right out of that rock comes a spring of beautiful, clean water. Well, that's a pretty powerful miracle. The people were very impressed. You see, so what's the first miracle that Jesus performs? The Gospel of John, we're told that he goes to a wedding in Cana. They don't have any more refreshments for the guests and things. They've run out of wine that they were going to serve for the wedding banquet. Jesus' mother, Mary, came to him and said, "We need help. We've got to have help." And so he had the servants fill stone jars. Those are jars carved out of the rock that serve for ceremonial purposes beside the door of the entrance into this home. When you came through the door, outside the doors was the city street, and the dust and the pollution that happens, they didn't have central sewer systems back in that day, and so when it rained, the stuff just washed down through the middle of the street. And when you came in off the street, you didn't want to bring that stuff in the house. Back in the old farm, back in Indiana, you took your galoshes off and you set them by the back door. That's the way you kept the stuff from getting into the house. All right? Well, in Jesus' day, they didn't wear galoshes. So they had these big stone jars, these vessels. They held about 30 gallons or something like that beside the door. And you'd wash your hands, you'd splash water over your face, get the dust out of your eyes, and you'd wash off the feet that had come in from the dirty street. It wasn't for drinking. These were stone jars used for ceremonial cleansing. Get straightened out, get cleansed off before you came in the house. He said, fill those stone jars to the brim, right up so that the water is spilling out of the jars. Nothing else can be added without something spilling out. And when they did that, and dipped out of that to take to the master of ceremonies, it had become wine. Moses touched the rock with his staff, and it became water from the rock. Jesus created wine in the stone jars. Which is stronger? Which is the more powerful miracle? Water can come from any place. Water is a natural occurring element. It's going to be there. But when the wine appears, it doesn't happen naturally. You don't go someplace and see a spring of wine springing up out of the earth. That's a creation from man. That's something we engineered, something we take care of. And Jesus produced good wine out of those stone jars. Okay, so we'll give that one to Jesus. He got the more superior. Okay, Moses said the people were hungry, so he prayed. And what was going to happen? Manna showed up the next day. Go out and get what you can for the day. Bring what you need. They got tired of the manna, and pretty soon he said, well, I'll pray. And quail came in, and they would fly very low. And the people would take a stick, and they would knock the quail down as they flew through the camp. And they would fix up duck soup or whatever it is that you do with a quail. I don't know exactly what you do with a quail, but you start off with one that's got feathers, and by the time you eat it, it doesn't have any anymore. And so something had to happen to it. We don't know exactly what manna was. We've heard stories about it, but we don't know exactly what it was. But Jesus, when he finds 5,000 people surrounding him that don't have any food, he takes 5 loaves and 2 fish and recreates bread and fish prepared to eat. These people didn't make campfires and make their own bread out of flour. They didn't make their own little spit and turn the fish on a stick and cook it. This was bread and fish prepared to eat, which is more powerful. Manna that comes from heaven and quail that fly through, or loaves and fish provided with 12 baskets left over. Oh, by the way, did I mention manna wouldn't last until the next day? The 12 baskets did. Well, it can't beat the one that Moses held his rod over the Red Sea. That's going to be a tough one. He held his rod over the Red Sea. The wind came, blew all night long. The waters piled up on both sides, dried out the ground on the bottom, and the people passed through on dry ground. Now that's an awesome miracle. Especially if you watch the old movie with Charlton Heston. Whew, that water was deep. If you believe your eye, you know, that was some miracle. Try to top that one. Well, Gospel of John, 6th chapter, 23rd verse, says that Jesus was seen walking across the surface of the lake of Galilee. The disciples had gone out and had started rowing across the lake. And if you know anything about Galilee, it's kind of an oval-shaped lake. But when you get out in the middle of it, it's about 7 miles across, something like that, between seven and eight, right in that area. They knew their location. That was their hometown. That's where they spent their lives there fishing. And they knew they'd gotten just about dead center in the lake when they couldn't go any farther because the wind was against them and they couldn't get where they were going. Rather than part the waters and walk across on dry land, Jesus simply walked across the surface of the lake to get where he was going. Which is superior? You see the contest? You see the dialogue they're having in Jerusalem, in the temple courtyard? That's pretty awesome. And then there's another little thing. The people of Israel walked across on dry ground. They're at least 3.5 miles from shore. How did they get to the place where they were going? My translation of the Bible says that they were instantly transported in total from the center of the lake, 3.5 miles at least, to the shore where they were going. Moses wasn't much for healing. In fact, one of the plagues was that he was brought sores and boils up on the population of Egypt. We know what sores are. We know what boils are. We know what they do to people that can be devastating. And we know that there's no cure for leprosy. So Jesus simply says to the 10 lepers at one time, "You are now clean. Go show yourselves to the priests." That's a hands down victory. I mean, that's a slam dunk. That's nothing but net. Moses creates sores, and Jesus heals from an unrecoverable illness, a death sentence. What was the final plague on Egypt? You remember the death angel that we're told was going to take one child, the oldest boy child, out of each family of Egypt? How many tens of thousands do you suppose that destroyed? Unbelievable the number of people that were wiped away in one night. It was enough to break the heart of Pharaoh and let him go. But which is more powerful? To slay 10,000 in a single night, or to raise Lazarus from the grave after having been buried for 4 days? You understand? These men knew Lazarus. They sat with him. They understood who he was. They understood his heart. They talked to him after he was raised from the dead. They knew it was the same Lazarus that they had put in the tomb 4 days before. And the leaders of the Jewish temple instantly recognized this miracle was so far ahead of anything that Moses had done that the only way to suppress the competition was to put Lazarus back in the grave at the same time they killed Jesus. To undo the miracle that God had done through Jesus' prayer. They plotted the death of their own friend to keep Moses ahead of Jesus. When Moses was faced with frustration, he was faced with blocked people who wouldn't obey, who wouldn't listen, who wouldn't surrender to God's will. In frustration, he reared back with his staff and struck the rock again. And another time when they were supposed to have water, God answered it. He brought water. He told Moses to speak to the rock, but he hit it with his staff instead. But Moses was tested at the rock and failed. Jesus was tested at the rock in Gethsemane on that last night of his life. And as he was faced with all the questions and with all of the issues and all the emotions and all the frustrations of 3 years of doing everything right, he stretched himself out on that big old slab of stone after trying to say, "Is there any other way? Take this cup away from me." But in the end, he passed the test because he said, "Not my will, but thine be done." He passed the test at the rock in Gethsemane. That's where the similarities tend to end. Both men die. There's no tomb that you can go to see where the men were buried. God buried Moses' body himself. Jesus resurrected his body. So there's no tomb that you can go to say, "Here's where he lies." And there's one more thing that they both faced. And I want you to just think about this now this morning. They both faced a divinely instituted blindness. Scripture calls it a hardening of the heart. If you look at what happened to Pharaoh, and I couldn't believe as a young man growing up, it just didn't make any sense what Pharaoh did. It was not logical. To put his country through that, his people through that. It wasn't logical to hold on to the people of Israel beyond the first or second plague. I mean, they'd have wiped me off just with turning the Nile to blood. I mean, that was enough to convince me this guy's got all the strength. I can't face that. To go all the way through to where he loses his own son in the death angel. It blows my mind. It completely blows my mind. I can't get my head around it. But even worse, I can't get my head around why they didn't want to have Jesus, even if he was replacing their hero, Moses. He had not hurt anyone. Ladies and gentlemen, the great divide in Jesus' own day was whether the people had a hardened heart or whether they had a softened heart. And now 2,000 years later, we face the same dilemma. I'm facing people all the time who go, "I don't need anything about that Jesus stuff. I don't need that Jesus stuff. I've heard enough about that Jesus stuff. Just leave me alone." And their hearts are just as hard as a stone. But there are people, and you may be one of them, who said, "I just need to hold on to somebody who loves me, who did nothing in the world to harm me, and everything in the world to love me." And those are the people that Jesus said are going to be a part of his new kingdom. Let go of whatever else you might have been holding on to. Let go of whatever else might have been the center of your life. Let go of any other heroes. Let go of any other role models. Let go of anything that you might have held on to. Look at Jesus. He said, "I'm going to show you how much I love you." And he stretched out his hands on the cross and said, "Father, forgive them, even for this." We talk about the altar being open, and it is. If you have any need for any purpose, we want to be partners with you in bringing your life closer to Jesus Christ.